In the 1950s, scientists started bombarding plants with radiation with the goal of encouraging beneficial mutations. And not only did it work, we still grow and consume a variety of plants that were developed this way. But how do we go from utilizing radiation as a means of mass destruction to essentially using it to water our plants? And what on earth does L. Ron Hubbard have to do with it? On August 6th and 9th, 1945, the US dropped two atomic bombs on Japan. The blast leveled two cities and killed somewhere between 130 and 230,000 people. The world had just witnessed the two most devastating and destructive man-made explosions in human history, and it was all made possible by atomic energy. As you might expect, this resulted in a roughly 2.5 billion people that didn't get murdered by this terrifying new technology to become somewhat, petrified of the power it possessed. But then some interesting reports started surfacing, detailing some of the plant life in the blast areas. Reports like this one, where a sesame stalk seemed to grow twice as high in irradiated soil as one grown outside the radiation zone. While there was some limited research into the effects of radiation on plant life prior to the dropping of Little Boy and Fat Man, the report of plant life in Hiroshima and Nagasaki significantly piqued the curiosity of the scientific communities and the general public. It had become much more apparent that there was more to atomic energy and radiation than just erasing cities and ending bloodlines. And world leaders took notice, with one deciding to bring that conversation to the global stage. On December 8, 1953, US President Dwight D. Eisenhower delivered an impassioned yet controversial speech to the United Nations, urging the global community to work together toward developing peaceful uses for atomic technology. The program the Eisenhower administration kicked off with this speech was called Atoms for Peace, and it was essentially a public relations campaign to encourage cooperative research into peaceful uses of atomic technology. Sounds pretty peachy on the surface, right? Not everybody thought so. The reason there was any controversy around this is that there were some, and still are some, that considered this a propaganda campaign. Probably depends on how you define propaganda, really. While Atoms for Peace wasn't a malicious power grab or full of misinformation, it did appeal to emotion, with many of the promotional materials giving off that propaganda vibe. As part of this Atoms for Peace campaign, the US government turned some of the labs used to develop atomic weapons into gamma gardens, more commonly known as atomic gardens. They began investigating the effects of radiation on plant life, and it basically went something like this. They set up a circular garden on about 5 acres with a retractable radiation source in the center, and shot gamma rays at the plants for around 20 hours. Then they retracted the radiation source and entered the garden, looking for plants that looked relatively normal. These would almost always be near to the outer edge, since the ones nearest to the middle were more likely to wilt and die pretty quickly. If we liken genetic modification to using a scalpel to sculpt, atomic gardening is like firing buckshot and hoping the holes produce some desirable characteristics. They studied these irradiated plants and seeds, and replanted some of the seeds, looking for mutations in the new plants that occurred as a result of these radiation buckshot blasts. While the highest level of research was done by the US government, atomic gardening wasn't reserved just exclusively for scientists and super secret labs. Anyone could grow plants from irradiated seeds. You could even apply to receive your own radiation source from the government, usually cobalt-60, and irradiate your own plants and seeds at home. Many people started trying their own hand at growing mutant plants by buying atom-blasted seeds from a man named C.J. Spees and planting them in their own gardens. Spees had built a bunker in Oak Ridge, Tennessee, inspired by the infamous lab nearby, and was irradiating seeds for sale to the general public. As atomic gardening rose in popularity among the public, a British atomic activist named Muriel Howorth founded the Atomic Garden Society to aggregate and share data collected from the public, essentially crowdsourcing public research. She solicited memberships and shipped out irradiated seeds and asked people to send in their findings to be included in their magazine. But to call the Atomic Garden Society part of the scientific community would not be entirely accurate. In addition to their data being essentially self-reported by people that were attempting to get featured in a magazine, one of their scientific advisors was L. Ron Hubbard, the founder of the Cult of Scientology, who claimed to be a nuclear physicist. He was not, in fact, a nuclear physicist, but that didn't stop the Atomic Garden Society from vouching for him. I don't know if Howorth just naively took him at his word, or if she knew that he was full of it and just wanted some of the publicity at the time. He was somewhat of a high-profile figure in 1960, with Scientology being formed in 1953. But whichever it was, it's a bad look now, and it severely undermines the credibility of this society in retrospect. And if you set set aside for a moment L. Ron Hubbard's beefy collection of bizarre claims and outlandish beliefs regarding Scientology, you're still left with just as beefy a collection of outlandish claims. For example, by using an electropsychometer, or E-meter, Hubbard believed that he proved plants can think and even suffer. He claimed that the readings he got on his E-meter when hooked up to a plant showed whether it was happy, anxious, depressed, or whatever. And he believed that if we found a way to keep plants happy, that they would grow better and we could increase the world's food supply. The dude really thought that he could sweet talk tomatoes into ending world hunger. And people still believe this dude.
They're insane.
Over time, atomic gardening started decreasing in popularity, due in part to the fact that speeding up evolution still takes a really, really long time. The odds of a beneficial mutation from an irradiated seed, while certainly possible, are incredibly low, and the successful cases were few and far between, leading many people to simply lose interest. But we do have some things to thank atomic gardens for. More than you'd expect, probably. Things like that peppermint taste in your toothpaste, over 70% of the grapefruit from Texas, over 85% of rice grown in California, certain varieties of chickpeas, ornamental plants, peanuts, wheat, barley, among many, many others. Over 2,000 varieties of plants were developed using atomic gardening techniques, and we still grow and consume many of those. While we don't really employ the same techniques nowadays, given that you can just outright edit genes now, there are still a handful of smaller labs running atomic garden experiments that are still in existence. Atomic gardens are cheap and pretty easy to set up, making them somewhat economical. However, they're extremely inefficient. Nowadays, we modify genomes directly with tools more akin to scalpels than shotguns. With technologies like CRISPR and its many variants, we can hunt out mutation hotspots in genomes and cut and paste away. Say what you will about the potential pitfalls and dangers of such technologies, but I don't think any of us anywhere can deny that this is a pretty fascinating time to be alive.